Hi there, and welcome to episode 2 of Overheard Orlando. This is the second full-length episode. Today, we're going to be diving into the tagline of this podcast, which is a personal philosophy podcast. I'm going to tell you what a personal philosophy is, what mine is, and we actually talked to 4 current and former Orlando area residents about what their take on it is. So without further ado, let's get into it. So as this podcast has been getting more exposure, I'm constantly asked, what is a personal philosophy? It sounds self-explanatory. It's not necessarily. So in the context of this podcast, a personal philosophy is the belief or worldview that dictates how we act or react to the world around us. It's how we perceive world events. It's how we perceive people. And it's how we perceive the actions of others. That last part is pretty important. My personal philosophy, personally, I believe that your life has only so many pages in it. I try to be really careful not to waste those pages on complacency anymore. And I don't mean this necessarily in terms of work or a job, as many people attach to the word complacency, but rather on situations of unhappiness or of just having a mundane life. I think that a lot of well-meaning rules or guidelines regarding life kind of block happiness in the exchange for safety. If you take this podcast, for example, I did tons and tons of research on podcasting and on different things. And there were certain rules of thumb that they kind of told you never to do or to always do that I kind of had to ignore to not be put in this box and kind of create the podcast I wanted. For example, you're supposed to have a podcast whose idea you can pitch within 15 seconds or less. Clearly, this episode would not exist if that were something that I were able to do. That being said, I've kind of brought my life to this point where I go after what I want in my own way, kind of unrelentingly and unapologetically. And when I do that, even if I don't get what I want or my life doesn't play out the way that I was hoping for, I gain a great amount of comfort and happiness in knowing that I tried. I know that sounds a little cliche, but if I tried my absolute best and it doesn't work out, I end up feeling more positive than negative about it. And at that point, I just adjust and I move forward. So that was a little bit about my personal philosophy. Let's see what some current and former Orlando residents had to say about their personal philosophy.
Hey, my name is Justin Mercado, and I'm from Deltona, Florida. I think the world is a journey for self-fulfillment and becoming the best versions of yourself. As people, we have the amazing ability to imprint someone's life with our positivity and perspective to help them reach that fulfillment. And some of the best social interactions I've had with friends and great individuals here in Central Florida, that will either be in Boxy Park in Lake Nona or in the Milk District. Being able to share ideas and knowledge with people gives me a better understanding of this world, and I'm happy to be a part of it here in Central Florida.
You know, in spite of this being the shortest submission that I received, I actually think there's a lot to be said here. I could easily make several episodes just on the ideas presented here. First and foremost, he mentions the exchange of knowledge and ideas, which I personally feel is responsible for some of the greatest and the most horrific things that exist in our world. He kind of mentions imprinting positivity and perspective on others, kind of how your personal philosophy can affect the day-to-day experience or someone's life in its entirety. For this reason, I tend to pay particular attention to how people make me feel whenever I'm around them. I mean, just the unspoken nuances of interacting with someone. I live for that shit. Let's move on.
Hi, I'm Eileen from Winter Park, Florida. I generally think that people are pretty indifferent to each other. I don't really pay a lot of attention to what my neighbors do, maybe on the surface level, in the same way they don't pay attention to what I do. I hope, and I can only hope, it brings me a lot of comfort to think I'm not being watched and observed. Because really, the only people that should be watching you and observing and judging what you do are your loved ones. Anybody else that is probably stalking you. So I like to think that the world is indifferent and that makes me feel good to be hidden, except for the ones I want to expose myself to. I have a few friends that like suffer from anxiety and they're always worried about, am I funny enough? What will people think about my singing if I get up on that karaoke stage? Is this a good song? Am I a good enough artist? And I think that they're amazing artists and I think that they are amazing singers or that they're the funniest person in the room and that's why I'm friends with them. But for them, it's about proving themselves to strangers, which I guess I want to do every now and then as well. But what calms me and centers me is not proving myself to people I have no relation or a real deep connection to, but proving myself to the ones that have proven themselves to me. In the same way, I use the term indifferent as a positive for me personally. I also use indifferent in a complex way where it's also the negative way that the world is indifferent. The world is indifferent to human rights and violations and climate change and harassment of people or what have you, the overthrow of a government. And it does suck and it is hard to have people care about things that really do matter. So that's why I think although you don't really have to prove anything to anybody else, you do have to prove things to yourself because life is indifferent. And at the end of the day, we are born alone and we die alone. But what we do along the way and what decisions we make and what we choose to pay attention to and the jobs that we choose to stay at, and that all matters to somebody. That matters to you at the end of your life, and that's going to matter to your children or your niece or your nephew. And that's why you can't be careless just because you are indifferent. Anyways, thanks for having me on, Steven. I look forward to hearing more from you, and I would love to hear your thoughts on all of this. Bye.
Thank you for that, Eileen. That was actually some really interesting stuff. First and foremost, I feel like this is a great anti-anxiety outlook. I mean, there really is a certain comfort in being indifferent. Personally, though, I do think that it's less about the acceptance of strangers and more about the hope that by making yourself vulnerable to others, that others will then in turn make themselves vulnerable to you as well. So many interactions, particularly the higher risk ones, for example, interactions with an estranged family member or interactions with a potential lover, they tend to feel like you're both just waiting. You're waiting for one person to take the jump first. You're waiting for, you know, you both have the gun. You're waiting for someone to fire it off first. However, if you do get to the point where you've both taken the jump, ultimately, that will lead to a stronger and more satisfying connection. It's just getting past that initial risk. Indifference, however, is good when it comes to strangers, if we're going to go down that route of discussion. There is definitely a certain kind of the precursor to paranoia, where anxiety in particular will make you feel like people are watching you or saying things about you when in reality they probably don't have an opinion on you or on the matter that you're worried about at all. On the negatives of indifference, you know, why do people show indifference to so many issues that are plaguing us? It's been a major talking point for about 15 to 20 years now, this whole apathy culture. I just think that it's a lot easier for people to do so, to be indifferent. There's definitely plenty of distraction in the world, which has its place and adds to everything. People tend to get to a place of being on autopilot. Kind of goes back to the complacency that I had mentioned. It's not a fun place to be. I've been there. It's definitely a waste of those pages that I had mentioned of your life story, going through the motions. Yeah, you definitely don't want to be there. If you're currently there, you can definitely reach out to me and I will do whatever I can to help you out. So here's a take next, which kind of expounds upon Eileen's take.
Hey, Steven, this is Brittany from Maitland. So I don't necessarily
view people as all good or all bad, or, you know, it is in some ways kind of hard to generalize people like that. But what I do believe is that most people are very self-serving. And what I mean by that is that, you know, it can be the simplest things. It could be, you know, you're driving and you know, someone cuts you off, or someone needs to go faster than you or something. And a lot of the time people be like, oh, look at that person. I'm already going so fast, and now they're going, 70 miles an hour or whatever the case may be. And we always bring everything back to self. And I think a lot of the time what people do has nothing to do with us. You know, and you can really apply that to anything in life. I mean, you can apply it to dating when someone doesn't choose you. You know, we view that as rejection and we get hurt and whatnot. But when you actually look at it, a lot of the time, it really doesn't have anything to do with you. It could be that that person is busy, or maybe that person found someone that's in better alignment for what their vision is for life. And so I think in general, we really have to stop taking things so personal and stop bringing everything back to us, and kind of, I would say, view everything more with compassion, right? Compassion for other people, compassion for ourselves, you know? It's like such an innate thing to bring things back to self that we have to give compassion to ourselves for doing that. But I also think that we need to really take into account too that the reality is it has nothing to do with us. And so we have to give ourselves compassion for that and recognize that and kind of be present with that thought so that we don't internalize things. But yeah, I mean, for the most part, you can't really say anyone is good or bad. I mean, think about even the bad things that people do. For instance, you know, someone robs a bank. It's all about them. It's not about, you know, oh, this place has money. No, this person is probably poor, or, you know, maybe, I don't know, maybe they need to provide for their family or whatever. And so they're doing it from this internal drive that they have. They don't think about things like that on like a deeper level, right? It's really not about anything to do with you. And I think that that not only applies to everything in life, but it also definitely applies to like our reactions with each other and just how we live day to day. I think it's extremely important to be self-aware and to recognize that and then be able to apply those things to your life. And when you see that someone is doing something and you are taking it personal, to be like, oh, look, that's what I'm doing right now. And change your mindset, you know, so that you're not seeing that as something that's about you.
So naturally, any discussion with the people of Orlando would include an example of a shitty driver, right? But on a serious note, I can agree with a lot of what's being said here. I do, however, tend to believe that cooperation and compassion, some more selfless traits, tend to be innate human traits. I think that's the reason that we fall in love, which, if done right, can be one of the most selfless acts people can take part in. That being said, I think there's a lot of selfish basal instincts that we do tend to give into. I believe that most people who do get hurt get caught in the aftermath of a selfish act. What we don't see in the scenario that Brittany gave us about the bank robber is the bank teller, who now has PTSD for the rest of her life and has to live with that due to staring death in the face, or what at least at the moment she perceived her death to be. Did the bank robber intend to inflict that harm upon her? No. Did he do it anyway? Yes. Earlier, I had kind of mentioned that in my own personal philosophy, I tend to chase the things that make me happy. I do try my absolute best, though, not to hurt anyone in the process. Usually, if I hurt someone, it's because I have failed to check the other person's perspective or point of view before kind of saying or doing something that was inadvertently hurtful. Just remember to be thoughtful whenever you can. Our next and final take is going to follow the same kind of path that this last one did in terms of fighting those innate and selfish drives in favor of something more compassionate.
Hey, my name is Sean. I used to live in Orlando. recently moved to Daytona Beach. I think my outlook on life is that one of the most important things for everyone to do, no matter where they are in their life or where they fit in society, is to constantly try to grow beyond what a lot of people's instincts and reflexive reactions to things are. Because I think a lot of people reflexively have a lot of anxiety or fear in their responses to things specifically that are new or different. And that when you inspect why you have those reactions and try to grow beyond them, that you become a better and fuller person. And in most cases, I think, become more likely to help those around you, to become more altruistic, to just do better things all around. And that a lot of the problems that we have, the core nugget of them worldwide, I think, no matter how big or small they may be, is that people are so distrustful of each other and so fearful of things they don't understand. And that if we could all learn to grow and get past that instinct that is just there, that's the first step to building a better future for everyone.
So again, we see anxiety used as an example here, and it really fits. As someone who has worked through quite a bit of severe anxiety myself, I know that it is absolutely crippling and has prevented me from a lot of things, a lot of opportunities. It's ruined relationships. And at the core, it felt like an absolutely natural process. And it is. However, it doesn't mean that it's not something that I needed to work past or get through. The same can be said for a lot of ideas that come naturally to us, but are essentially holding us back from being better and enjoying our life more. Another absolutely natural and innate thing that prevents people from moving forward, people tend to employ a myriad of different defense mechanisms. They serve a purpose. They're set to defend our emotions, to protect us from being hurt or humiliated or anything like that. However, more often than not, these defense mechanisms tend to be self-destructive and also destructive to anyone trying to get close enough and getting caught in the blast. I think that oftentimes these natural reactions or thoughts that are plaguing our everyday interactions with each other are also affecting us on a global scale and kind of can be found at the core of a lot of world issues. Anywho, I just wanted to thank you so much for all the love and positivity I've received in just the 1 month that this podcast has been live for. This podcast is already growing exponentially faster and greater than it should be, given the short amount of time that it's been out, and I have you to thank for that. I really appreciate that. Thank you so much. So if you'd like, we can actually continue this conversation. You can contact me at overheardorlandopodcast@gmail.com. I also have a Google Voice number. You're free to text if you have any questions for me, or even call and leave a voicemail, 407-735-6494. Or you can follow me on Instagram, @OverheardOrlandoPodcast. As always, all of the music you hear on this podcast is by Neon Dreams. Please check him out on Bandcamp. Thank you so much again. Stay true.